Please help us to see Yeshua in all his glory and fully trust in him. In his name we pray. Amen. Yeshua is in Jerusalem. He is revealing himself there in the midst of the Feast of Tabernacles of Sukkot. He has revealed himself as the light of the world. Another I am statement that John has recorded for us. And then John has also recorded for us the interaction that he has had with the, particularly with the unbelieving religious leaders. And as we concluded our studies the last time we were here in John chapter 8, we came to verse 30, which John writes, as he, that is Yeshua, spoke these words, many believed in him. There was opposition, there was challenge, and yet it seems that there was at least some surface belief. Then Yeshua speaks to those in particular, at least in the first part of this next segment. And Yeshua says to them in verse 31, to those Jews who believed him, if you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed, and you shall know the truth, and the truth shall make you free. Words that perhaps we are quite familiar with. Yeshua, throughout this gospel, is very aware that there are people who will seem to be followers and disciples who are not genuinely so. So there's a mixed group here. There are those who are in direct opposition to him. We know that he has his disciples who are genuinely following, and that there are some that claim to follow, and yet perhaps not. And Yeshua makes it very clear, begins to help us to see what it means to genuinely know him, to be his disciple, to walk with him. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. The word of God, the word of Yeshua, is a very powerful thing for us. You remember what Peter said at the end of chapter 6. Yeshua had given a hard teaching. Many had turned away. Many were those who were not genuine in being disciples. And this is what Peter had said after Yeshua had asked the question, do you want to go away also? In chapter 6 and verse 68, Simon Peter answered him, Lord, to whom shall we go? You have the words of eternal life. Yeshua had encountered Peter and the others in chapter 1, and we had seen that encounter, and he had called them to follow, and they had grown to see him, and their trust in him had grown ever deeper. Some years later, Peter will write in his first letter about a relationship with Yeshua. In his first letter, the first letter of Peter, chapter 1, Peter writes these words, beginning in verse 22. of incorruptible through the word of God, which lives and abides forever. Because all flesh is as grass, and all the glory of man as the flower of grass. The grass withers, and its flower falls away, but the word of the Lord endures forever. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached to you. The word of Yeshua. The word that declares that he has come from the Father, that he was with the Father through all eternity, that he does only what the Father has shown to him, that he says only what he has seen with the Father, that he is speaking the very words of the Father, that these words are the good news, that he is indeed the Messiah, the Savior of the world, the Lamb of God sent to take away the sins of the world. This is the gospel. This is the good news. This is the word of Yeshua. This is the word that a true, genuine disciple remains in. This is the word that is revealed in Yeshua, that he is the word. In the beginning was the word, and the word was God, and the word was with God. And this is also the word embodied in this book that we have the privilege of carrying and reading, studying, and having God speak to us yet again. This is the very word that God himself spoke in the beginning. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth, and he did it by the power of his word. We remain, we abide in, we dwell in, we are at home in his word. And Yeshua will say later on his last night on earth, before he goes to give his life on the cross, if my words remain in you, if you remain in me, and my words remain in you, you can ask whatever you wish and it will be given you. So it's not just that we remain in the word remains in us as well. And Peter has highlighted for us that this word is the very way that we were born again. That was what Yeshua had been talking to Nicodemus about, that we must be born again. There must be a supernatural intervention in our lives if we are going to have life. And that happens through the word of God, through him speaking again into existence a brand new life as we come to trust in him. This word that does not perish and spoil or fade, this life that does not perish, spoil, or fade as we come into relationship with him. We abide in his word. And if we abide in his word, then we are genuinely his disciples. This is not a flash in the pan kind of thing. This is something that goes deeper and deeper. Over the years that I have walked with the Lord, there have been various moments where my relationship with the Scriptures might have been sporadic. Some days I didn't read, maybe even some weeks I didn't read Scripture or didn't engage with it. And yet, as time has gone on, the power of God, the desire that God has placed in my heart, I'm sure is as yours. The thirst has grown deeper. The longing to understand. There are days when as I read, I feel like I have plunged into the midst of the ocean and I cannot plumb its depths. There are days when it feels like it is a mighty mountain that I cannot grasp, that it is higher than the heavens, reaching to the ends of the universe, because it is indeed the word of God. And yet, the Spirit of God comes and helps us, and we understand that we begin to see life according to God's point of view. As we have heard Yeshua say, I am the light of the world. in his light we see light. We come to understand the way things really are. If you abide in my word, you are my disciples indeed. And his word is truth. And in fact, Yeshua will say later on, we know this, we've heard it before, he will say that I am the way and the truth and the life. I think ultimately the truth is a person. The truth is Yeshua himself. He will make statements that are true. And there are things that we are needing to believe and to know as true. But truth is ultimately a person. We will know the truth. We will know Yeshua himself, and the truth will make us free. Now, verse 33, there is an objection. They answer him, "We are Abraham's descendants and have never been in bondage to anyone. How can you say you will be made free?" Is that necessarily completely true? On the one hand, Jewish people have been in bondage to Egypt, Babylon, and now in this day to Rome. And yet, even though that there were political entities that had enslaved them, it was always their heart's desire that they live in freedom. And they relished the promise of rescue from Egypt, and they relished the promise of Messiah who would come and rescue as well. But again, they were looking on the surface. They were looking at an earthly point of view. And Yeshua, in verse 34, answers them, "Most assuredly, truly, truly, I say to you, whoever commits sin is a slave to sin." Now, some think that Yeshua, or that the Gospel of John, is an anti-Semitic piece of literature because of the way Yeshua responds to these religious leaders, and because of what he will say later on in this very chapter. But Yeshua is helping us see reality. Anyone who commits sin is a slave to sin. Can any of us raise our hand and say we are truly free apart from Yeshua? You see, the whole planet, every human being has committed sin and is a slave to sin as a result. For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God, Shaul would write in his letter to the Romans. Are justified freely by what Yeshua will do. We sin because we are sinners. As soon as Adam and Eve listened to the lie of Satan, as soon as they turned their back on the Word of God and chose to believe the lie of Satan, something happened in them. Brokenness, fallenness that happened that they transmitted to the whole human race. That there is in every human being a bent to do that which is opposed to God. Now that does not say that there are not good things that humans do. There are wonderful things that people do all the time. Who do not know God, do not have a relationship with him. But if we were to look in the inner attitude, in the inner heart, we see that inside there is a slavery to that which is against God. And there is a commitment to self, a commitment to I. Everyone verse 35, a slave does not abide in the house forever, but a son abides forever. And then he says, therefore, if the Son makes you free, you shall be free indeed. You see, Yeshua is the Son of the house. The letter to the Hebrews makes this clear, highlights to us that Yeshua is a son, is the son in the house. Moses indeed was a faithful in all his house as a servant for a testimony of those things which would be spoken afterward. But Messiah has a son over his own house, whose house we are if we hold fast the confidence and the rejoicing of the hope firm to the end. Yeshua is the one who can give us true freedom and make us children of God and give us a place in his home forever. Yeshua and Yeshua alone is the one who can set us free indeed. And what is our slavery to? Isaiah saw it. He said, all we like sheep have gone astray. Each of us has turned to his own way. And the Lord has laid on him, the Messiah, the iniquity of us all. And then in the letter to the Hebrews, in chapter 2, verses 14 and following, there is the deepest slavery of all. Hebrews chapter 2 and verse 14. Inasmuch then as the children have partaken of flesh and blood, he himself, Yeshua, likewise shared in the same, that through death he might destroy him who had the power of death, that is the devil, and release those who through fear of death were all their lifetime subject to bondage. You see, we are bound by our own sin. And once we have given in to sin, once we have chosen that way and manifested ourselves to be sinners, we are also bound by the devil, and we are also bound by death. And death is a horrible specter that no one can avoid. Statistics are in. As we look at statistics, 100 out of 100 die. Yeshua has come to set us free. And how does the son of the house set us free? Verse 37, Yeshua writes back in John 8, know that you are Abraham's descendants, but you seek to kill me because my word has no place in you. I speak what I have seen with my father, and you do what you have seen with your father. Yeshua then will begin to focus in to try to help these unbelieving people, some who have claimed to believe, perhaps now joined by the unbelieving religious leaders, that they are claiming that they aren't in slavery because they are descendants of Abraham. But Yeshua says that he's only speaking what he has seen from the Father. He is only speaking about this slavery because they don't recognize they are slaves to sin. Yeshua, how does he rescue? The reality is that Yeshua rescues us from the fear of death by death. That is an incredible mystery. In the first letter to the Corinthians, Shaul, describes it in this passage, first letter to the Corinthians, chapter 15, verse 1, he says, "Moreover, brethren, I declare to you the gospel which I preached to you, which also you received and in which you stand, by which also you are saved if you hold fast that word which I preached to you, unless you believed in vain. For I delivered to you, first of all, which I also received, that Messiah died for our sins according to the Scriptures." You see, that's how Yeshua sets us free. He paid the price for our bondage, our choice to rebel against God. He paid the price for our sin according to the Scriptures. And he was buried, and he rose again the third day according to the Scriptures. He was seen by Kepha, Peter, and then by the 12. After that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at once, of whom the greater part remain to the present, but some have fallen asleep. And after that, he was seen by James, and then by all the apostles. Then last of all, he was seen by me, as one born out of due time. I am the least of the apostles, says Shaul. I am not worthy to be called an apostle because I persecuted the congregation of God. But by the grace of God, I am what I am, and his grace toward me was not in vain. But I labored more abundantly than they all, yet not I, but the grace of God which was with me. Therefore, whether it was I or they, so we preach, and so you believe. And then at the end of this chapter, verse 56, why is death a great fear and a great grip on humanity? Verse 56, the sting of death is sin, and the strength of sin is the law. What is Shaul saying to us? He is saying it's impossible for us to keep the law of God in our own strength. Once we have violated the law of God, there is no way that we can ever turn back on our own strength. We can never keep the law of God in our own strength. And therefore, this sin holds us in bondage, and it makes death an awful thing. It's a terrible thing anyway that it invaded our earth. But it gives the sting of death. The sting of death is sin. And the power of sin, the strength of sin, is a law that doesn't have the power to save, only the power to reveal. Then we see why the gospel is so glorious. We see what God accomplished through Yeshua's death. But thanks be to God, who gives us the victory through our Lord Yeshua Mashiach. Because, O death, where is your sting? O Hades, where is your victory? Yeshua has taken away the sting of death. That first prophecy that was given to Eve in the garden, that he would crush your head and you would bruise his heel, Genesis 3:15. That is how Yeshua sets us free. Yeshua, through his death on the cross, crushed the head of the serpent, dealt with our sin, and took away the sting of death. That is how he did it, in the death of death, that Yeshua could not be held by death, because he was a perfect sacrifice, absolutely perfect. He fulfilled the law of God. He walked with his Father. He remained in his Father's words. He did all the will of his Father every minute, every second of his entire life. And then he willingly, voluntarily laid down his life as a sacrifice, as a sin offering, a perfect, spotless, without blemish, Lamb of God. And in so doing, death could not hold him. And the Father raised him up, and death, the sting of death, was removed. And therefore, that's how Yeshua can say to us, if I make you free, you are free indeed, because we've been rescued from the bondage of sin, we've been rescued from the bondage of the fear of death, we have been rescued from the bondage of Satan. Before any person can be rescued, though, they must acknowledge that they are in bondage. And that's what Yeshua was seeking to do with this group. The ones who had, there were there those there who had genuinely believed, there were those who genuinely didn't believe, and there were those who thought they believed. And Yeshua was helping them see that you must acknowledge your bondage. And that genuine faith looks like this, and abiding in the Word. And that if the Son sets you free, you are free indeed. But Yeshua continues then. They're resistant to what he has said. He's saying, I speak to you what I've seen with my Father in verse 38 of John 8, and you do what you have seen with your Father. And in verse 39, they answer and they push back and they say, Abraham is our father. And Yeshua said to them, if you were Abraham's children, you would do the works of Abraham. Sooner or later, it may take some time, but sooner or later, what a person genuinely believes comes out in their actions. This was true for Abraham. He has become the picture of genuine believing faith. In both the letter to the Romans and the letter that James wrote, he is used as the picture of genuine faith. And what does it say about Abraham? That he believed God and it was credited to him as righteousness. And it says that he believed God in spite of being 100 years old and his wife being 90, and it looked as if it would be impossible to have kids, but God had given a promise. And so Abraham looked at his body, he looked at his wife, he looked at the promise of God, and he chose the promise of God because he had found God to be true. Over the years, God had made promises to him, and he believed them and he lived it out, so much so that when it came to the time when God said, sacrifice your son, Isaac, Abraham did it, and as far as I can tell in the text, there's not a grappling, there is a trust that God will keep his promise, that it is through Isaac that his seed will be. And so if God's going to have me sacrifice Isaac, he must going to raise him from the dead. That was Abraham's belief. James says that his faith was confirmed by his action. And James highlights for us, not in contradiction to Shaul, that we are not saved by works, but when we are genuinely saved and have genuine faith, there will be works that follow. There will be evidence in our life. Even if it's small, there will be evidence in our actions, our words, in our thoughts. And so, if you were Abraham's children, Yeshua says, you would do the works of Abraham. You would trust the Father. In verse 40, but now you seek to kill me, a man who has told you the truth, which I heard from God. Abraham did not do this. You do the deeds of your father. They want to kill Yeshua. They do not believe what he is saying. They do not think he is from God. And then they say, push back again. Verse 41, then they said to him, were not born in fornication. We have one Father, God. So they take this discussion one step further. Their resistance is one notch deeper. And they say, not only is Abraham our father, but God himself is our father. And in verse 42, Yeshua says to them, if God were your father, you would love me. No one can have the Father without the Son. If I reject Yeshua and all he says about himself, I can claim to the day, as long as the day is, that I know God, but I'm not telling the truth. Without Yeshua, you cannot have God. If God were your Father, you would love me, says Yeshua. For I proceeded forth and came from God, the very bosom of the Father, face to face with the Father from all eternity. I have come from the Father, from God, and I have not come of myself. I came because the Father sent me. For God the Father loved the world so much that he gave his one and only Son, his only begotten Son, who came on purpose in consonance with the Father. Why do you not understand my speech? Yeshua continues in verse 43. Because you are not able to listen to my word. You can't hear. You're blind. Isaiah, when he saw that glorious vision in chapter 6, once he saw the vision of God and he saw his own sinfulness, and he humbly bowed before Almighty God in this revelation, I think, of Yeshua. And he said, woe is me, for I am undone, for I am a man of unclean lips, and I live among a people of unclean lips. And then the angelic being flew to the altar and with tongs took a coal and touched his lips, and his lips were not burned, but they were purged clean because it penetrated all the way to his heart. From the altar, he was clean, cleansed. And then he said, as a result of this freedom, he said, here am I, Lord, send me. After God said, who shall I send and who will go for us? And then in that moment, God revealed to him that he would be speaking to people who would hear but not hear, who would see but not see. And he said, how long shall I do this? And he said, you continue to do it, and you continue to do it, and you continue to do it, and in spite of their resistance, there will be a remnant. Yeshua is showing us the glory of his love. You hear, but you don't receive my word, he said to them. You aren't really listening with your heart. You aren't receiving it. And yet, as long as they had breath, in these moments, Yeshua continued to speak out of the love that he had for them, out of the love of the Father. And then, in words that seem so strong, in verse 44 of John 8, Yeshua says, you are of your father, the devil. Can you imagine to be called? You say you have God as your father, you say you have Abraham as your father, and then Yeshua says, no, your real father is the devil. Wow. And yet, we have to remember, he was saying it in love. He loved these people as he has loved us. You see, at sooner or later, love must tell the truth, because it is only in knowing the truth that we can be set free. If we are living under an illusion, we cannot be set free. You are of your father, the devil, and the desires of your father you want to do. What were the desires of the devil? He came into existence because he wanted dislodge God. He wanted to take God's place. He wanted to become God. And in a couple of places in the Tanakh, there are glimpses of him, a glorious angelic being who became twisted in his very heart, and in a series of I statements proclaimed that he wanted to go higher than God, and of course he could not. And we see him entering into the Garden of Eden, into that perfect couple, that innocent couple, through the creature, the serpent. And he directly contradicts God. He lies. He says, "You will not surely die if you taste this fruit." It was a direct lie. And after they believed the lie and they died spiritually, it wasn't long before the murderous intent of the evil one was manifest when Cain killed Abel. The first murder. The devil, his desires, he was a murderer from the beginning, Yeshua says. And he does not stand in the truth because there is no truth in him. When he speaks a lie, he speaks from his own resources, for he is a liar and the father of it. I grieve when I think of every time I've ever listened to the evil one. All he can do is lie. Even when he used scripture at the temptation of Yeshua, he took it out of context and twisted it. The scripture was true. The way the devil used it was a lie. He may disguise himself as an angel of light, but sooner or later, he manifests himself. And two ways that we can know for sure that he's lurking somewhere around is murderous intent and skirting around the truth. A liar, the father of lies, a murderer from the beginning. Verse 45, "But because I tell the truth, you do not believe me." What an amazing contrast. Yeshua, the glorious Son of God, the Messiah, tells the truth, and they don't believe it. These who have known the scriptures, the promises, the covenant of all people, surely they should have known, and there were some who did. But the religious leaders at this point as a whole did not. And then this incredible statement in verse 46, "Which of you convicts me of sin?" And the implied answer, no one. No one can convict Yeshua of sin because he is without sin, perfect. And if I tell you the truth, why do you not believe me? He who is of God hears God's words. Therefore, you do not hear because you are not of God. Out of love, Yeshua is doing this. Things will get even more intense as this interchange continues. But let me come back and conclude with this. What about you? What have you concluded about Yeshua? Have you come to trust him? Have you trusted his word? His word becomes precious to you. Have you seen Yeshua is the treasure hidden in the field, valuable, more valuable than anything else in all of life? Have you seen that Yeshua is that pearl of great price, elegant, beautiful, glorious? Is Yeshua the one that you have come to love and trust? If so, you are free indeed. And if not, this day, you can take that simple, humble step of saying to him right hand, that trusting in him we might have life, that we might be free indeed. O Father, manifest your glory this day. Anyone who has not trusted you, may they do so in this moment. And for those of us who have trusted you,